Amy Green, thank you so much for joining us. Really appreciate your time today.
It's my pleasure.
Let me ask you about the reporting that you're currently working on. You just recently went to Astor in Lake County, which is one of those communities that really suffered months-long, relentless flooding after Hurricane Ian. What are you seeing in communities like that now? Where are they in terms of their recovery?
Well, I think what people in Astor are experiencing is very similar to what Floridians across the state are dealing with, which is that this hurricane season is starting at a time when, for a lot of people, it feels like the last season never really ended. I don't know if you feel that way, but you know, across the state, more than 1,000 households remain displaced, and they are in temporary housing supported by FEMA. You know, Floridians that are back at home are still dealing with repairs. And, you know, in Astor, that's a community that's situated right on the St. John's River, which there was a lot of flooding associated with the river after Hurricanes Ian and Nicole last year. And that community really experienced kind of like a 1-2 punch with the hurricane season last year. You know, just as the water was beginning to recede after Hurricane Ian, Nicole came along and dumped even more rain. I talked with one resident there who says his house was inundated for about a month.
You mentioned it there, that Astor is a particularly vulnerable place. And one of the things that Ian and Nicole brought into stark relief was that inland areas of Florida are so vulnerable to flooding, much like we think of coastal areas. And I wonder what makes Astor itself and places like it particularly vulnerable. Is it just its proximity to the St. John's?
Well, in Astor, it's because of its proximity to the St. John's. That community is right on the St. John's. People who live there, you know, that community is very centered around the river, and people live there because they enjoy being close to the river. And so people who I talk to don't have plans to move away because of last year's hurricane season or anything like that. And one man who I talked to actually is adapting his house as he's working on his repairs and doing things like raising up a backyard deck and adding sand fill to his backyard to try to prevent the water from getting inside his house the next time there's a storm and there's flooding. But Florida is a low-lying peninsula. Yep. And so, you know, again, the rainfall amounts we saw with Hurricanes Ian and Nicole, and with Ian in particular, were unlike anything we've seen in our state for hundreds of years, if not longer. And so that's why we had a lot of that flooding that, you know, we experienced last year. And we're seeing communities, you know, make big changes because of that, because we know that with climate change, hurricanes will become rainier because as the atmosphere warms, it can retain more moisture. And so just for example, here in Central Florida, in New Smyrna Beach, they agreed last year to put a temporary pause on new residential developments so that community can go back and understand some of the hurricane impacts that they experienced. And here in Orange County, another neighborhood that was very affected was Orlo Vista,
yes.
Over toward the west side, and Orange County commissioners have agreed to invest in some drainage improvements there to try to improve the situation.
You talked about some of the practical steps that people in Astor are taking, and probably there's a lot of trepidation given what they experienced last year. We don't know what we might experience this year, but what are the predictions looking like? I mean, you're writing about that at the moment.
Right. So there's good news and there's less good news with that, Steve. And so the good news is that meteorologists are expecting below average activity this hurricane season. But they also say that there is a lot of uncertainty about this season, and that's because there are kind of two opposing factors developing here. The first is the likely development of an El Nino, which can discourage hurricane activity in the Atlantic, and an El Nino is a climate phenomenon that can affect weather events across the globe. But scientists also say that surface temperatures in the Atlantic have warmed more rapidly than normal, and of course, sea surface temperatures can enhance hurricane activity and make hurricanes more intense. And so the bottom line is that it's possible that what we'll see is a fewer number of hurricanes, but that those that can develop, they might be stronger.
I mean, put in context what below average means. It doesn't necessarily mean much below average, right? And it doesn't mean that we won't get a major storm.
Exactly. So just for context, meteorologists are expecting hurricane activity this season to be about 80% of the average. And just by comparison, hurricane activity last season was about 75% of the norm. And of course, last year's seasons will be best remembered for Hurricane Ian, which was one of the most costly hurricanes in U.S. history. We also had Hurricane Nicole, which was very impactful in Central Florida. And Hurricane Fiona also caused devastating flooding in Puerto Rico. And so it's important to remember that, you know, it's always good to be prepared because, you know, while there may be fewer hurricanes this season, it only takes one hurricane to make the season a bad one for you.
I want to pivot and talk about the environmental record of Governor DeSantis, and the eyes of the political world are currently on the governor, of course. Let's just talk about that a little, because he has won some praise, hasn't he, from environmental groups. I mean, he signed a law in 2021 establishing the Resilient Florida Program. How has the governor's record been received by environmental groups from your reporting?
Yeah, so let's go back in time. And if you can remember, Steve, 2018, when Governor DeSantis was a gubernatorial candidate, and you'll remember that at the time of his campaign, that the state was really in the grips of this horrible toxic algae crisis. And across the peninsula, waterways were fouled and stinking with this toxic algae. And so Governor DeSantis could see that this was an important economic issue for the state of Florida. And so he really made that a central issue of his campaign, and it worked for him. He was elected, and very soon after taking office, he initiated a series of environmental actions in Florida aimed at addressing water quality problems in the state. And at the time, it was, I would say, an exciting time for a lot of environmental groups, because you'll remember that his predecessor was Rick Scott, who really gutted environmental programs in the state. He very famously banned the words climate change from state agencies. And so, you know, it is true that Governor Ron DeSantis has done a lot more on the environment than Rick Scott, but at the same time, that's not saying a whole lot. He has invested a lot of money into his Resilient Florida program, which is aimed at fortifying the state's infrastructure against rising seas and more damaging hurricanes. But the environmental groups would be very quick to point out that he hasn't really done anything to address the main environmental threat in our state, which is climate change, and to address the thing that is causing climate change, which is fossil fuel emissions.
Well, that's interesting you mentioned that, isn't it? Because the state does refer to sea level rise and the threats that are posed by that. Why is there that sort of disconnect, do you think, in the politics of the governor? And are we likely to see that continue?
Yeah, I was looking back at my notes this morning. He has said that he's not really a global warming person. He has said, you know, that's not a label that I want on me. You know, I think these are issues that he is viewing through an economic lens. And again, he can see, you know, the economic importance of addressing some of these issues. He has, you know, done a lot and invested a lot of money in things like Everglades restoration, water quality programs, resilience projects. But he hasn't really done anything to move the state toward cleaner energy sources.
And you've covered a lot of those stormwater projects as it pertains to the Indian River Lagoon, where there has been stepped up efforts to clean up that waterway.
Right, yes. The Indian River Lagoon has really been troubled for a very long time. This horrible manatee die-off has been happening in the Indian River Lagoon. And so, you know, that is a water body that is like a lot of water bodies in the state, you know, that has really suffered with a lot of nutrient pollution and stormwater runoff. And that's one of the things that DeSantis has focused on in his environmental policy.
Well, we really appreciate your important reporting on the environment, Amy. Amy Green from Inside Climate News, thank you so much for coming in.
It's my pleasure.